Turn your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. And what I want to do today is look at just the first four verses here of the book of Colossians and talk a little bit about some of the terms that are used here and how we can apply this in our lives. So let's start by reading the first four verses here of Colossians chapter 3. Start in verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the time we have to study your word, to gather together as saints and have the fellowship around your word. And we pray that this morning as we look at your word and the scripture and the verses here and the words on the page that we take it to our heart, to our soul, that we apply it in our lives and that we choose to walk by faith and not by sight and walk by your word. Amen. So in Colossians chapter 3, what I want to do here, I titled the message originally Hide and Seek, and then I just said, well, let's make it Hid and Seek, because that hid is the word used in verse 3. And I knew grammatically that would annoy everybody. And so far, all the guys in the AV room keep asking me if I spelled it wrong. So, but what I want to talk about is a few terms here. So in verse 3, you'll notice it says seek. In verse 2, it says to set your affection. And then in verse 3, it says your life is hid. And I want to focus in on those three points. And I don't know about you guys, but I find Colossians 3 is probably one of my favorite chapters. I think Colossians 3, you know, Romans 12, there's certain passages in Scripture that really encapsulate not only the doctrine, but the practical application of it. And so Colossians 3 does that. You know, when you look at verse 5, it says, mortify therefore your members. You start to talk about how you live your life, the practice. And if you turn over to Colossians 1 real quick, you'll notice here, Colossians 1 can give you a quick, a very general outline of the book of Colossians and divide it up into two sections. So in Colossians chapter 1, verse 9, it says, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. So you see in verse 9, he's talking about being filled with the knowledge of the will and his wisdom. And then verse 10 is walking worthy. So you have the doctrinal application, and then you have the practice of that doctrine. You understand the doctrine first, and then you live that out in your walk and in your daily life. So Colossians has four chapters. The first two chapters are dealing with the doctrine. And the last two chapters, chapters 3 and 4, you're going to start applying that. That's going to be the walk. That's going to be your practice. That's your sanctified walk you're going to be living. And so when we get into Colossians 3 here, what you're doing here in the first four verses is what Paul's doing is he's taking everything he's taught in the first two chapters, and real quickly, in just four verses, he's condensing it down, and he's using terms and words that are designed to make you remember, designed to make you think about things you've previously learned in the other chapters and in the other books. And so in Colossians chapter 3 here, you see that the first four verses give you that doctrine, and then you live that out. That's why it says in verse 5 to mortify your members. It's how do you conduct yourself? And then it talks about in verse 9, lie not one to another. How do you deal with other members of the body of Christ? Putting on as the elect, verse 12 says, to put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, forbearing one another. Verse 14 talks about the charity. Verse 15 and 16 talk about that the word and the peace dwelling richly in you. And then in verse 17, whatsoever you do. So there's that walk. There's that application of the doctrine. Husbands, wives, children, fathers, servants. So you start in chapter 3 with a reminder of that doctrine that is instantly applied then in the application of your life. Colossians 3 is the kind of chapter you could read every morning and that jump starts your day in understanding who you are and what you're supposed to do. If you look at the first few verses of Colossians 3, you'll notice three tenses. So in verse 1, it says, if ye then be risen. So that if you be risen, that's a past tense. And then you have in verse 2, it says, verse 3, and your life is hid. Your life is hid right now. There's the present tense. In verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, there's the future tense. So you have them dealing with the past, the present, and the future. And you have it all culminating. You have it all being condensed down into just these four verses. And so when we get into chapter 3 here, we've already learned about who Christ is in Colossians 1, the fullness of him to fill all in all, who he is to the church, who he is as the fully satisfying redemption and payment for the sins of mankind, and how in Colossians chapter 2 it talks about the rudiments of the world. It talks about how we aren't supposed to be beguiled by human wisdom and human reasoning. If you look back at chapter 2, verse 20, it says, wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why is the living in the world are you subject unto ordinances? He's reminding them, we aren't subject to the ordinances. We aren't subject to the law. We don't live our life on an outwardly fleshly performance to look a certain way. That's not the way we operate. Because we're dead, it says in verse 20. We're dead with Christ. So you think about that terminology and what we've learned. Now look at chapter 3, verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ. So in 2:20, he says dead in Christ. Here he says risen. So what you have is you've got these terms being used that are supposed to jog our memory about other passages in the Bible. So if you look at, grab Philippians chapter 3. Grab Philippians chapter 3. And you'll notice throughout Paul's epistles, he uses terms, the way he writes, he's not just telling us everything and being just commandment. There's obviously, he commands a lot of things in these passages. He says, you know, set your affections. He's telling you what to do. But he uses terms and words to get us to think. He wants us to apply critical thinking. So that's why he says, if ye be risen with Christ. Now, is he calling into the question the saints and Colossae if they're risen with Christ? No, he's not questioning whether they're saved. What he's doing is he's challenging their thinking. He's saying, because we've gone through two chapters, if you are risen, are you risen? Of course you're risen, because you're dead in Christ. And if you think about what we know about, say, Romans 6, which we'll get there in a little bit, it explains that identification process. We're identified with Christ. So when he says, if ye be risen with Christ, in Philippians 3, verse 9, and be not found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. See, we're risen with Christ. We're seated in heavenly places. And the rudiments of the world is not where our righteousness comes from. That's not how we live and how we serve. Because Philippians 3 says we have his righteousness. Our righteousness doesn't come by our works. It doesn't come by us performing the law and serving in that way. It comes by the faith of Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross. And so our life is supposed to be lived not by us trying to produce on our own, but having an understanding of the identity we have in Christ and his righteousness that we now have. And so that's what's going to set up these verses here and how we're supposed to operate. And so we need to think, when it says, if ye be risen, we are risen. It's not whether or not you are or are not. It's since you are risen, here's how you're supposed to live. Here's how, see, he's challenging you to think through the process. He's not just saying, do it. He's saying, if this truth is real, then what does that truth then result in you doing next? What's the next logical progression? You know, you think of Romans chapter 12, the same concept where it talks about being beseeched. And it says your reasonable service. As you realize that you can be a living sacrifice for God because it's reasonable that now that you're in Christ and you're a servant, you should be living that life. So if you look at Colossians 2 now, so when it talks in Philippians 3 about the righteousness without the law, that we have that faith, in Colossians 2, he touched on this already in verse 6, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. How do we operate? We aren't operating. See, what can happen is people can get saved, and then instantly be told, now that you're saved, here's what you have to do, and here's a list of things. And right away, the first thing so many Christians do is they instantly fall into legalism. They instantly put themselves back under the law, back under the rudiments of the world. And in Colossians 2, he's saying, as you receive Jesus Christ, how did we receive Jesus Christ? By faith. So walk ye in him. So when we get to Colossians 3, and now we're talking about that walk and that practice, how are we supposed to operate in that walk and practice? It's the same way. It's by faith. So look back at Colossians 3 here, and we'll look at verse 1. It says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. So when it talks about us seeking those things, well, before we get to the seek, the being risen with Christ. Now, he talked about this the previous chapter, so turn over to chapter 2 and look at verse 12, Colossians 2 and verse 12. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. And ye being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Isn't that great? He didn't just forgive you of your sins, but you were buried with Christ, and you were raised as proof, as the receipt paid in full, that your sins were paid for. And you're risen with Christ, and we're seated now with him in heavenly places. So if you are risen, you are risen, because the moment you trust what Christ did on the cross for your sins, that he paid the price completely, your old man is crucified, your sins are paid for, and you are identified and you are risen with Christ. So you have the life of Christ. You are risen with him. And so that should jog your memory about Romans 6. If you look at Romans 6, that idea of the identification. And in Colossians 2 and Colossians 3, we see he says things, if ye be dead, if ye be risen, ye are dead. Whenever you hear those type of terms, the first thing you should be thinking about is Romans 6. In Romans chapter 6, let's start in verse 3. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? So there's that death issue. We were placed into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him in baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For ye have been planted together in the likeness of his death. We shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. So when we've been identified with him in his burial and his death, that is to identify and for us to acknowledge that old man has been buried and put to rest. It's gone. It doesn't have that dominion and that power over us anymore. And verse 7, for he that is dead is freed from sin. The what that produces in our life, the truth and the reality that produces is that old man is dead. He's gone. We're not schizophrenic. We don't have two personalities. We don't sometimes put the old man on and sometimes put the new man on. That old man is dead. Now, do we still sin? Do we still have the habits? And does our mind still function and operate, or I should say want to function and operate, in those old men thinking and mentality? Yes. But does the old man have power over you anymore? Are you still run by the old man? You're not. It's gone. He's dead. And that's the truth and the reality we need to live in. And then, by the way, Romans 7, you're also dead and you're freed from the law. The law has the power of sin. And so not only are we dead from the old man and sin, but we're also freed now from the law. So again, if you think about Colossians 3 or Colossians 2, where it talks about the rudiments of the world, should we be obeying and following and operating in the law system? No, because we're freed from that. Going back to the law would be the same thing as going back to the old man and saying you have to serve the old man. So look at Ephesians chapter 2. So in Colossians 3, he says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. And in Ephesians 2, I love this passage because this is how sure and confident we can be about that identity. Because you can say, oh, well, yeah, I get that we're identified with Christ. We're buried in his baptism. And you can kind of make it seem like it's this vague thing, and it's just something that you can't grasp. But this passage tells you so much. In Ephesians 2:6, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places. In who? In Christ. Where is Christ now? At the end of Mark, where does he ascends up, and he says he sits at the right hand of God. This says right here that you're seated at the right hand of God because you're in Christ, aren't you? So think about it. That's a present truth and reality. It's not you will be in heaven. You will be seated up there. That's in the present tense and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So when it says, if ye be risen with Christ, you are risen with Christ. You have his life. You've been identified with his death, his burial, his resurrection. And you are seated right now at this moment in the positions of the heavenly places in Christ. And in verse 4, we'll talk a little bit more about that. And so we need to remember that's where we are. We are risen. That is the life we have. So our new life and identity is accomplished with what Christ did. We've been identified with that and buried and dead to sin. And now we've been risen and given his new life. So if you look at Colossians 3 again here, says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 1, if ye then be risen with Christ, so because of that understanding and truth, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. So he tells us you're supposed to seek something. That idea of seek is, you know, you could think of it as searching something out. But it has the idea of a desire too. So turn to grab Psalm 63 and Psalms 73. Psalm 63 and Psalms 73. And once I hear the pages stop rustling, I'll give you guys a second. So Psalm 63, if you look at verse 1, O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. So here King David saying, I seek you. Early will I seek thee. And it talks then about the water. Like you're not just seeking something out, but it's something you're desiring. You want it. You need it. You feel like you crave it, right? Look at Psalms chapter 73. Verse 25, whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. So you see, David, he had this mentality where he seeked God. He seeked his word. He seeked him out. And I love in verse 25 that he says, I have in heaven but thee, and there is none upon the earth that I desire more. See, he's understanding that what my desire is you. And isn't it great in Colossians 3 says, seek those things which are above? So his desire is that, and he's weighing in the balance. There's nothing here on this earth that I desire more than you, that I seek more than you. And that's the mindset we need to have. So turn back to Colossians chapter 3. Actually, before you get Colossians 3, turn to Ephesians 1. And I want to go to look at a few verses there. So when we think about us seeking and desiring, it's that idea of seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. So if we're going to seek, if we're going to desire something, we need to know something. We need to be getting in the book. We can't know the will of God if we aren't in his word. God does not operate today by whispers and dreams. You're not going to get a vision in the middle of the night of what God wants you to do today. That's not how he's going to work. Because he's given us his word. He's given us his complete word. And our job and our responsibility as members of the body of Christ is to be in this word. The verse we love to quote all the time in 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourselves approved unto God. We're supposed to study. And we're not studying to be approved to our friends here or to act like we know more or have more knowledge. It's approved unto God. The relationship, what this Bible is a relationship between you and God. And you don't want to be ashamed, not to the world around you, to God. So we're supposed to study it. And as we study it, we're going to seek out, we're going to desire the things of God, because if you look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. So here's an example. Hey, we're blessed with something. What are we blessed with? Where's it located? Is it on the earth? The verse says it's in heavenly places. Right? Seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. So we understand now, as we go through God's word, that we have some blessings. In 2 Corinthians 5, it talks about we have a tabernacle not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. We have a home. We have a new body. We have a glorified body waiting for us up there. We have that hope. And if you look at Ephesians 1 at verse 18, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. We're supposed to know what God's got going on for us. We're supposed to know what it is that we are seeking that is above. There's an inheritance God has. God doesn't just save us because he felt bad for us and didn't want us to go to hell. He's got a plan and a purpose. You aren't just a consolation prize. You aren't a pity save. God saved you because he's got a plan in the heavens that we're a part of. Now, if he's excited about that and he sends his only son to die on the cross for our sins and mankind's sins to accomplish that plan and purpose, shouldn't we be excited about that? Shouldn't we be desiring to know what that's about, to be thinking on those things? Look at verse 20, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. So again, their own right hand, that make you think of Colossians 3 and Ephesians 2. Verse 21, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. God's design, God the Father's will and plan and is to have his son be the head over the entire creation in heaven and in earth. And what Paul prays here, this prayer in Ephesians 1, is that you be enlightened, that you have an understanding and an appreciation of where you fit in with that and identifying who you are. So you're not just seated with him in heavenly places for no reason. You're part of the plan. You're part of the inheritance. That's why in Romans 8, he says that you're not only heirs of God, but you're joint heirs with Christ. Because who are you in? You're in Christ. That is our life now. So our affection, our desire, what we should be seeking is to know about that, to appreciate that, to want that. So turn back to Ephesians chapter 2. And what he's going to do now is he's going to not just say, seek those things which are above. Now in verse 2, he says, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. So he's making a command here, right? Set your affection. This is what you should be doing. And then he references the two realms again. Things above, not things on the earth. It's amazing. You go the first verse in the Bible, God created the heaven and the earth, right? There are two distinct realms. And you're here now in Colossians 3, and it's the same thing. There's two areas of thinking. And based on if you're in the dispensation of grace or if you were in time past, it affects which one you're focusing on. Israel, with their earthly kingdom, their focus was on the earth. But we aren't Israel. We aren't spiritual Israel. We are a new creature, the member of the body of Christ. And as Ephesians 1 said, we have that calling. Our hope, it is not here on the earth. It is in the heavens. So the idea in verse 2 where it says, set your affection. I want you to grab Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16. in Matthew chapter 16, verse 23. So this is right when Jesus is telling his disciples, hey, we're not going to be able to set up this kingdom. I'm going to have to die and go to the cross, and this is what's going to happen. And he says in verse 20, then charged he his disciples that he should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. You think about that verse in Hebrews 12 where it says that when Christ, with what he did, when he sacrificed his life and he died on the cross, it talks about the joy that was set before him. So Christ is understanding what's got to happen. He's understanding the big picture. But look at verse 22. Here's Peter's response. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, "Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men." That term savorest, you think about what Peter's doing. Is he setting his affection on what mattered, or what was he being focused on? See, his mind wasn't in the right place. His mind was on the earth. He's thinking, we're going to set up the kingdom right now. I think about in the garden when Jesus is betrayed, who's pulling out his sword and ready to physically fight for that kingdom? It was Peter. What was his focus on? What was his desire and his mindset? It was off. It was wrong. And that's why he gets rebuked. Jesus rebukes him here. Because he's savoring. He's desiring. He's setting his mindset on the wrong thing. He was deceived from it. Grab 1 Thessalonians 2 real quick. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. First Thessalonians 2, verse 13, says, "For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe." This verse right here is telling us that God's word works, and it works in us. And so in Colossians 2, when it says, "As you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him," we are supposed to, by faith, be taking God's word and applying it to our lives, to not just know it as information, but to reckon it, as Romans 6 says, and believe it and count it to be true. That's what works in us. So in Romans, turn to Romans 8. Grab Romans 8 and grab Galatians 5. Romans 8 and Galatians 5. This is that process that needs to take place. In Romans chapter 8, look at verse 4. "That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh." There's that idea of, well, set your affection on things above. What are you minding? What are you valuing? What is your focus on? "For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." We are supposed to set our affections on things above. We are supposed to mind those things that are above. Our mindset is to be, and it says, set your affection. It is to be rooted and grounded and established in his word, in the doctrine. So then in Galatians chapter 5, he uses similar terminology here. Look at verse 17, Galatians 5:17. "For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that they cannot do the things that they would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law." Remember, we're not under the law. Those rudiments aren't what control us today. And these things, the flesh and the spirit, they don't go together. You're not operating in both of them. Peter was an example of that. What was his operation? He was not operating in the spirit. He was not operating with the right mindset. So we have to be renewed in God's word. We have to let it effectually work in us to mind the things of the spirit and set our affection on those things. The proper focus. I was thinking of an example of this. When you think back to the book of Genesis with Jacob and Esau and the soup and the pottage, he comes in and he's starving and he tells his brother, hey, I'm about to die. I need some soup. And he says, okay, well, sell me your birthright. And his response is, yeah, no problem. I mean, I'm about to die. What good is a birthright to me if I'm about to die? How is he valuing his birthright? He's valuing it as an earthly, temporal possession. Now contrast that with Abraham and his son Isaac. He's waited all these years for a son, and he finally gets the son, and God says, okay, now I want you to go make a sacrifice. And you're going to sacrifice your son on that altar. What was his focus? Well, if all he was thinking about was the earthly stuff, he'd be like, why would I sacrifice my son? This is the blessing you promised me. But see, he knew there's a resurrection. He knew that there's that eternal life value. And he knows that the power of what God can do to raise him from the dead. So you have two examples of one focusing on the temporal and the earthly, the not being spiritually minded, and the other one having that right mindset and understanding. So an example for us then, in Paul's epistles, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, start in verse 14. Knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. And that's what we've been talking about. This is Paul explaining that process, that the minding the things of the Spirit. He's understanding that the outward man's perishing, that inward man's... How is the inward man renewed? We are by faith reading God's word and applying it to our lives. It's effectually working in us that believe. It's building us up. We're established in the faith. Verse 17... For our light affliction, which is but for a moment. And by the, you know that when you read chapter 11, it was not light affliction that Paul was going through. If your focus is earthly, you're not reading that chapter 11 and thinking that's some light affliction. The only way you perceive chapter 11 as a light affliction is if you are minding the things of God, if you're walking in the Spirit, if your mind is set and your affection is on the eternal things. It's the only way you can do that. Because that's if you don't have the eternity in mind, you can't say it's a light affliction, but for a moment. And it says, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. That's what our focus has to be. That's how we evaluate the circumstances and the situations in our lives. We evaluate it through the lens, through the mindset, through a set established thinking about who we are in Christ and having our affections set in the heavenly places and that identity. And when we do that, we focus on the eternal. I was thinking about this. If you, right before you go on a vacation, let's say you planned this nice vacation, you had it planned for months, and you got that last week of work. Maybe let's say the last day of work. How focused are you on your job on that last day? You hear people say that all the time. Right? Oh, he's already checked out. You're already thinking about what you want. That's the mindset as Christians we should have every day. We have to operate in this world. We got to own a house. We got to buy a car. We got to pay bills. We got to have a job. I get all that. I'm not saying that we don't have any investment in this life. But our mindset should almost be like that. That should be secondary. We should be constantly waiting, thinking, and setting that affection on the eternal things, the weightier things. And we should just kind of be cruising through the rudiments of this world and the things that we have to do, the mundane things. That's not what our focus is. That's not what's getting us bent out of shape. That's not what's that's ruining our day and making us angry and allowing that to affect our lives. So look at, go back to Colossians 3 here. And we'll look at verse 3 now. So with the idea of setting our affection, we need to be setting our affection on the things above, because that is where our life is, and that is where we are seated in heavenly places. It's where our blessings are. When you say your life, I mean, that's everything. You are in Christ with God, and you're seated in heavenly places. That's where our focus should be. Because what tied us to this world is dead. That old man is dead. So in Colossians chapter 3, verse 3, if ye be, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. So here now you've got, for ye are dead. Well, we looked at verse 1, it says, if ye then be risen. Chapter 2, verse 20, wherefore if ye be dead with Christ. So again, these terms about your identity, he's clearly provoking thought to you to be reminded about your identity. See, these first four verses of Colossians, it's he's not going back to the ABCs and reading you the entire book of Romans for why you should now have this certain walk and practice. But he's challenging you, and he's putting terms in here that should be jogging your memory to convict you and convince you of how you're supposed to walk. So here, for ye be dead, and that takes you right back again to the Romans 6. You're dead with him, and you're buried with him, and you're risen with him, and you're given his life. See, if you look at Ephesians or Galatians 2, go to Galatians 2 real quick. Grab Galatians 2 and then also grab Ephesians chapter 2. Galatians 2 and Ephesians chapter 2. So in Galatians 2, and I know we all know this verse, verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. Where did we learn that before? Romans 6, right? Nevertheless, I live. There's Philippians 3:9, the righteousness of God. That's how we get his righteousness, his life. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. This verse is the proof, the evidence. This is the culmination of taking Romans 6 and understanding your identity, and taking 1 Thessalonians 2:13 and letting it effectually work in you. This is what the mindset looks like then. Because you're dead, yet you're alive. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ live in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. The life you're living isn't yours now anymore, because you're dead. You know, you think about that idea of being dead. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespass. You were dead spirit. In Ephesians 2 here, he's talking about the spiritual death. Obviously, you were physically alive, but you were spiritually dead before you were saved. And all you did was walk according to the course of this world. And you fulfilled the lusts and the desires of this world. You were spiritually dead. Now he quickens you when you get saved and makes you alive. See, he doesn't just spiritually now make you alive. He also, before he makes you spiritually alive, it says in Romans 6, he kills and crucifies the old man too. You're twice dead. You were dead spiritually, and before he makes you alive, he has to kill that old man too. And he crucifies the old man. So you're twice dead. But in Colossians 3, turn there, he says, Colossians 3:3, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. You're twice secure. You're in Christ. Christ is in God. How much more secure can you get than that? I mean, should you have any worries or doubts about the future if that's your position and your identity? Ephesians 1 talks about how we have, after we've trusted and believed, that we're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. See, what we're waiting for is that redemption of our body. We're waiting for that rapture. And God says, until that happens, I'm going to give you my Spirit. That's the earnest down payment. So you have the Holy Spirit in you as an earnest down payment, and you are in Christ, or you are with Christ in God. That's security. That's what we need to be able to rest in and trust in. And so the Holy Spirit seals us. Colossians 2, God the Father there raises Christ from the dead, and we're raised with him because we're identified into that burial and resurrection. And then Colossians 3 shows that we are hid in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now look at verse 4. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Now that's talking about that future glorification. It's talking about the rapture, or the Bible would call it the catching away. So now he's changing the focus to what that future looks like. And you think about that. Turn to Ephesians 1:13 real quick. Let's just read that. It says in verse 13, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. When you trusted that gospel, when you trusted what Christ did on the cross, the full, complete payment for your sins, he was buried and rose again the third day. When you put your faith and your trust in that, you're sealed with that Holy Spirit. And we're given that Holy Spirit, it says in verse 14, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession. We're already purchased. And he's saying, you're getting my Holy Spirit until that time comes when I come back to get you. I mean, so you're not only hidden twice, you're not only hid with Christ in God, but he's also given you a down payment. That's something you possess right now too. And he's saying, that seal is until I come back to get you. So you think about, when you think about your security, God would have to reject his son, who he rose from the dead, and you rose with him. So he'd have to reject his son to be able to reject you. And he would have to take away the Holy Spirit that you have, that you're sealed with, which he promised he would seal you with until the day of redemption. God would have to take back everything he says and promises in the word. Now we know God cannot lie. And we know he's faithful. So how much more confident can we be in our security? I mean, that's just wonderful. And Romans 8 is just the icing on the top of the cake. He goes through every possible thing you could imagine to separate you from the love of God on this earth. And there's nothing, including you. You can't do anything about it. You know, you can look around the world and be like, yeah, nothing can stop me. But don't we get in our own heads sometimes and doubt and question, or maybe feel guilty? There's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. We are sealed with that Holy Spirit until the day of redemption. And our life is hid with Christ. Look at Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2, verses... Well, let's read verse 11, 12, and 13. By the way, this 11, 12, and 13, you have another passage here where you have a past, present, future, just like in Colossians 3. So in verse 11, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. There's your past, the past tense. Verse 12, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. That's the way we're supposed to live. God's grace teaches us by faith applying his word. And then verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what we're supposed to be looking for. We are setting our affections on things above. We are minding the things of Christ. And our focus and our desire and our thinking is to be in light and in line with God's word. So we should be looking for that hope. If you look at, let's grab, go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So when you think about your life being hid in Christ, or hid with Christ in God, we have his life. We're identified with him in his burial, in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. But we're still on this world, on this earth. And so we're looking for that blessed hope. Now, we aren't just stuck here because there's not anything for us to do when we're waiting for something. We know in 2 Corinthians 5, it talks about we're ambassadors for Christ. And, you know, to be an ambassador is the idea, you're a foreign diplomat, you're a diplomat on foreign soil. So think about that. We're seated in heavenly places. Christ is seated in heavenly places. We are with him in Christ. But we're still here on the earth. We haven't gotten that glorified body. We haven't gotten to the heavens yet. The rapture hasn't happened. We're ambassadors, though. This isn't our home. This isn't where we belong. But we're here. We have a purpose. God has a will that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So the ambassadors. See, if our focus is on the eternal things, then we understand what we do need to do down here. We renew our mind. We do Colossians 3 where we're renewing our mind and we have this walk, a sanctified walk. But we're out there sharing the gospel. We're getting other people saved. We're letting them know about the truth of God. In the world that we live today, the answer is not going to be fixing politics. The answer is not going to be getting out there and involved in your local community trying to protest and do politics. It changes in your home first. It changes in how you treat your wife, your husband, your kids, how you talk to your coworkers, how you share the gospel with people in your community. Because You know, just like I know, the only thing that makes a change in our lives is God's word and being saved and given his life. You can't go out there and fix up the world. Remember, it's dead, spiritually dead. It's run by the old man still. You know, when God saves you, that old man is gone. It's dead. He's not covering it up. He's not rejuvenating your old man. With my profession, I fix cars. I fix interiors of cars. And I get asked all the time, oh, can you fix this seat? And it'll have a really big tear. And they're like, well, I said, I can't do that. Like, well, can't you just put a new piece of leather on it? I don't do reupholstery, I do repairs. See, with my job, I polish up the old junk. I don't make it brand new. I make it look brand new. So if there's a little scratch or a little stain, I put some paint on there and polish it up. See, your old man is dead. It's not polished up. It's not covered over by a facade of righteousness. It's completely gone. You are completely new. 2 Corinthians 5 says that you are a new creature in Christ. That old man, that old identity is over with. But we're still walking around in this body, aren't we? But look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. You know, that treasure, that life that we have, we're still in that earthen vessel, but that power is in us. And it has the ability to work out through us. Philippians 2 talks about shining. We need to shine as those lights to a dark and crooked world around us. We have the power and the excellency of God in us. We have the ability to live that life, to be an ambassador, to as we operate and if you take Colossians 3 and you're operating and you're mortifying the deeds of the flesh and you're forbearing and showing long suffering and forgiving and husbands, be not bitter against your wives, and don't provoke your children to anger, and your servants obey your masters in all things. If you're operating and walking in that flesh, you are representing something to the world they don't see. Because does the world operate that way? Now, maybe occasionally, you know, they put on a good show. But a genuine life walk that way, based off of a renewed mind in God's word, you're putting that excellency of the power of God on display to the world. And you're doing that in light of who you are in Christ and setting your mind on the things above. Let's close. Let's see. Turn back to Colossians 3, and we'll close it up here. Now, your life is hid with Christ, and someday he's going to come back for us. And this earthen vessel that has that excellency is not going to be in an earthen vessel anymore. It's going to be displayed to the world. We are going to be caught up to meet him in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And that life, well, that life won't be hid anymore at that point, will it? Colossians 3, verse 3, "For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Mortify therefore." And so I love that word, therefore. So those four verses, now it's therefore. So my encouragement to you today, go home and read the rest of Colossians 3 in light of the first four passages and what we've talked about, where you identify that you're risen with Christ. You're seeking the things that are above. You're setting your affection and your mindset on the things above, not on the earth. You're understanding that you're dead and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And you're looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior. Therefore, mortify your members. Verse 9, lie not one to another. Verse 13, forbearing one another, forgiving one another. Live your life based on that truth. So I would encourage you, when you go home today, read the rest of Colossians 3 in light of that. That's what we're supposed to do every day. So as David said, I seek him early. If we go out in that world unprepared, without a renewed mind, it's going to eat us up. It's going to alter our thinking. We're going to be like Peter. We're going to get focused on the earthly things. But if we spend our time and we wake up early and our focus is on his word and a renewed mind, and walking by faith, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. That's the life that we need to be living. Amen? All right. Heavenly Father, thank you again for the time and the saints that have gathered here. We're thankful for your word, the fact that we don't live in doubt and question, not only about what you purpose and plan and will. We have it in front of us in your word. Let us take that and cherish that. Take that seriously. That should sober us up. We don't need to guess what you're doing. We know what you're doing. It's in your word. And let us, by faith, walk in that and let it effectually work in us. Be ambassadors for you and a light to a world around us that is looking for a hope, that is looking for life, that is looking for something to fulfill that void. We thank you for your Son, his love, and your grace. Amen.